Thank you for spending your evening with us tonight for our first Urban Idea panel for this year, How We Win 2015 and Beyond. Urban Idea is an incubator for new ideas and approaches to urban and regional development from a progressive perspective. This is just the first of a series of forums this year, so stay tuned for those. I'm a member of the steering committee for Urban Idea, and I'm very happy to be moderating this event this evening. By the way, I'm Diane Ruiz, co-founder of online multimedia platform People Power Media. So we have a great lineup of community experts for discussion tonight. Thank you all for being here. And thank you to the Bayanihan Community Center for hosting this event. Considering what we're talking about tonight, it's really the perfect place for this discussion. The Bayanihan, in my native language of Tagalog or Filipino, refers to a spirit of communal unity or effort to achieve a particular objective. And what we're talking about tonight is how can we come together as a progressive community to achieve victory in 2015 and for long-term movements. We're not just talking about ballot measures and electoral politics. We're talking about building and sustaining a progressive agenda through the strengths in our communities that will translate into legislative victories in the immediate term as well as long-term support. First of all, who here has volunteered for the elections last year, either for a candidate or for a proposition? Hands up. Great. So I'm sure this is a pretty politically savvy crowd, but I'll start us off with some context of the situation here in San Francisco. And then I'll talk about the results of last November's 2014 election. So a quick shout out to Mario Yedidia, I saw him earlier, political coordinator for San Francisco Rising, for helping me out with this. So, San Francisco, home to the fastest growing inequality gap in the U.S., a housing crisis that is known worldwide, longtime residents being pushed out from skyrocketing rents, no fault and Ellis evictions, and gentrification. The city administration under Mayor Ed Lee is continuing the pro-market trickle-down remedies of past administrations. It's an administration that is bringing out the red carpet to welcome new industries with tax breaks, transportation privileges, and changes to zoning with little regard to the impact to existing residents. And the Board of Supervisors is consistently unreliable with its minority progressive bloc. But in the true spirit of San Francisco, progressives are fighting back. Last year, Prop J passed, putting San Francisco's minimum wage on track to be the highest minimum wage in the country. Proposition G came out of a resurging tenant movement and a series of neighborhoods, then a citywide convention. Although Prop G lost, it's worth noting that the grassroots effort that came together to get the 100,000 votes in favor was outspent 12-1 in this race, including an over $800,000 contribution from the National Association of Realtors. Other notable measures was the passing of Prop C, which supports city funding for San Francisco's young people, and the passing of Prop K, so the housing balance legislation will look to maintain 33% to 50% affordable housing for low and moderate income residents. The biggest candidate race of the year was the Battle of the Davids. District 9 Supervisor David Campos going up against District 3 Supervisor David Chu to replace Assemblyman Paul Amiano in Sacramento. After a hard-fought battle, Chu beat Campos by 2,625 votes. While Compost won the day of voting, a testament to their excellent DOTB drive, there were 22,000 more votes cast by vote by mail in the 17th Assembly District than were cast in person. So that, along with being outspent, were a couple deciding factors. Now, looking at this year, Mayor Lee is up for re-election, and there isn't a high-profile candidate running in opposition, with former Assemblyman Almiano and Senator Mark Leno both bowing out. So what will this mean for voter turnout, for negotiations for upcoming ballot measures, for the housing crisis? A few ballot measures we've already been talking about are a new housing bond and opposition to the Airbnb legislation. There are also moves being made around setting up progressive candidates for the supervisor races in 2016. So given all of that, what are we going to do this year and moving forward? What new political realities do we need to change or acknowledge? What have we been neglecting? What do we have to remember not to ignore as we shift our tactics? What can we do to build progressive movements when there isn't an election looming? We turn now to our panel. I'll go over in more detail about our esteemed panelists as they speak, but now a quick overview. USF Professor Corey Cook is going to give us a breakdown of his analysis of the last election, including demographics, and what about that tech vote? District 1 Supervisor Eric Marr will be talking about how to reach out to West Side voters. After Supervisor Marr, there will be Nate Alvey, legislative aide to David Compost, and Nate also ran his election campaign for Assembly. He's going to be talking about vote by mail and money and politics. And so we don't get too distracted by our shiny new tactics, Emily Lee from San Francisco Rising Action Fund will be talking about the work and investment that needs to happen in communities of color to build a progressive agenda. And in the same vein, organizer Maria Zamudio from Casa Justa Just Cause will close us off by sharing a DOTB plan for the traditional progressive-based communities of color. So I'll be guiding the conversation, and there will also be plenty of opportunity for you to ask questions. So you should all have a piece of paper underneath your seat to write questions down, and you'll have to share pens. So after each speaker, we're going to have 5 minutes of questions from the audience. So while they're speaking, you're going to write down your questions and pass them.
University of San Francisco and director of the Leo T. MacArthur Center for Public Service and the Common Good. His research and teaching interests are in urban and California politics and multiracial, multi-ethnic political coalitions. So, Professor Cook, tell us about the voting patterns of last year's election.
Hi, everybody. First, just thank you for the invitation to be here and to be on such a distinguished panel. I actually brought 34 slides. So I'm going to go really quickly here. A few of them just to let you know that they're available. I'm happy to, just generally, I'm a data nerd, so I'm happy to make anything available to you to hear. If there are other things you'd like, to make them available to you as well. So I'm gonna just going to highlight some things that we know, and then really try to highlight a few key points that I think you might find useful. So if we can get started now. So this is just to get a sense of how segregated San Francisco's electorate is. And so what you see in the maps here, this is voter registration by race and ethnicity. That does not seem focused at all. It might just be me. It might be old age. So interesting. In the 11th, some of this is African American population. So here's a giant shadow. but trust me that there is something there as well. We'll advance the next one. The next set are by party, and this will shock everyone, I'm sure, to know this is a heavily Democratic city. So this is precinct by Inter Democrats. These are Republicans, there are a couple here and here. And these are kind of state voters, which are interestingly remote party registrants. Okay, so this is turnout. in 2014. This is the turn on 2014, and on the upper left, again, but in the upper left-hand corner, you have regular voters. So that's for folks who regularly participate in elections. So again, it maps pretty clearly. Now, those who vote in 5 out of the last 6 elections are who voted in November of 2014. So, you know, this is a fairly common low turnout voter pattern that we saw in this election. I don't even know what that is now. It's the, these are new voters. So these are folks at like 27% Asian Pacific Islander, 6.8% Latino, 2.7% African American. So again, you can see the differential from population to registration to participation, regular participation in elections. Obviously, the converse is true. These are color coded by Georgia's Royal Precinct, so you can find some areas where it is seemingly out of alignment, which I'll get to a little bit in the ballot issue. Okay, so I did a little bit of math on the results. And what you find, I'll just highlight this to make stuff. So Asian Pacific Islanders, this is possessed of the precinct voters. So the demography of the precinct voters and the outcome. Precincts with higher proportions of Latino voters are more likely to vote. It turns out that new voters turned out not to matter very much. Regular voters, regular voters were, again, negatively correlated, so the higher the number of regular voters in the precinct, the worse the compost did. One of the things that's happening now in elections is this top two primary thing. My estimate is about 4% of that, so basically the swing in that election were Republican voters. You know, it's the margin of victory Republican voters. But there's an important thing to know, which is there are these new category of voters that we know statewide as orphan voters. Those are voters who may be Democrats but then have a ballot that are two Republicans, or Republican voters have a ballot that has two Democrats. It turns out that actually a lot of those voters turn out they roll off at higher rates. Actually, if you use them for the next one in particular. So those voters are actually more likely to not vote, to roll off if they are of the same party. So Republican voters, the highest coefficient by far of those who cast a ballot but did not vote in two compost rates was precincts with a lot of Republicans in. So even though they're used to voting for Democrats, typically in municipal elections, when they see a race that has two Republicans on it, statewide about 55% of voters don't vote if they don't have a party of their own in the race. So in a district like this one, about half the voters actually, Republican voters, roll off. But we know that she got a significant majority of those voters, and I think that's not exactly pretty close to the margin of victory. I'm out of time completely. I haven't talked to anybody about it. We'll do a couple quick things. We'll just go really fast. So if you can just put forward a couple. Okay, so I'll go off that. Let's go to the next one. So this is Prop A. And part of the question was sort of, this came up a lot after the election, is the analysis of who won the election. And of course, the mayor claimed victory because everything he supported won. And then yet you look at maps like this, and everything the mayor favored won because progressive voters voted for disproportionately. So it's sort of hard to say sort of which side won when you have like Prop A, the more progressive voters voted in favor of A. You go to put two more. This is Prop B. Similarly, again, more progressive voters are more likely to vote for Prop B. If you look at Prop C, again, voters disproportionately likely, again, the more progressive precincts voted in favor of C. And we can actually do this all night. But the point being, in all these ballot measures, whether you're talking about Prop G, the anti-speculation tax, if you're looking at K, the mayor's measure, if you're looking at the minimum wage increase, all those measures were disproportionately favored by progressive voters. Which made very interesting then the analysis after the election of the mayor saying everything I voted for passed, and then they passed because progressive voters voted for them. So he claimed victory, which isn't probably surprising, but probably a lot of progressives claimed victory too because the things they voted for passed. So last thing about tech voters. Right now tech voters aren't yet a significant voting bloc. We don't know yet enough, and I'm hoping I'll know more in a couple of months. But basically, looking at the voter file, if you look at voters who are between, and we're sort of guessing here, right? So voters between roughly 24 and 35 who are new registrants in the last year, who are living, their registration address is near Google bus line. the last couple of years.
The next thing is they linked in each of the individual names and figure out where they work. But at least for that cut, so to those folks, it's about, in the voter file, about 10,000 to 15,000 voters.
Wait, what?
So it's about 10,000 to 15,000 voters. So it's significant. But if you look at the number of new registrants since in the last year, it's 100,000 voters. So tech is not yet participating. The assumption is they will, but again, at least according to the voter file, they're not participating. And new registrants didn't vote at high rates. So a lot of folks who registered since January didn't vote in November. So there's still a looming change in something to that. Thank you.
Governor Marr will be talking to us about how progressives can reach out to Westside voters.
Thank you, Diane. Let me first say that there's a tremendous resource of everyone in here that has quite a bit of experience in many generations of movements. I'm Eric Marr. I came out of the 80s as a radical student activist. Some of us were part of left organizations in the 70s and 80s, and really antagonistic towards electoral work. I think until the Rainbow Coalition campaigns of the 1984, which I jumped into, like a lot of my colleagues, and then in 88 as well, but Rainbow Coalition chapters as one model. I know there's some of us, like Huli and others, were part of the community congresses of the 70s in neighborhood by neighborhood, building a power and a voice for different neighborhoods as well. There are different times where some of us tried to form the San Francisco Progressive Alliance or the San Francisco People's Organization and different formations, but my hope is that I don't become a Debbie Downer with what I'm going to say right now, and I move towards optimism that to this side of the but progressives are getting our asses kicked, not only in ballot initiatives, but also, like Prop G is kind of the best example, the anti-speculator tax, but also we're down to three, some people say four to five, that's three to four progressives on the Board of Supervisors when we had a majority and could drive an agenda in the past. But I'll just say that I think one of the reasons is a lack of infrastructure from the outside and a lack of communication and dialogue with that outside to the inside, and then even within the Board of Supervisors, the 11 of us, or even the four, three to four progressives, we don't communicate nearly enough, and there's lots of egos and opportunism that, and not an outside organizational movement that's holding us accountable to work together for a common good. I wanted to say that as a supervisor for one of the areas that Corey talked about, that's a more moderate one, though I will say that there are pockets of progressivism according to the Progressive Voter Index, but even when you overlay the Progressive Voter Index that Corey talked about with emerging progressive sentiments in communities of color, I think there's a lot of opportunity up there. But in the inner Richmond where I live, there's clearly a different political character than the outer Richmond. But I think we should look at districts monolithically, or even in the Sunset District where a lot of the Noah G and some of the conservatism voted, there's a strip of the along the Ocean Beach area and the Great Highway where you have more progressivism. But I think as we look at electing progressives or even liberals that progressives can work closely with in tactical alliances at times, it's really important to look at the demographic, the Progressive Voter Index, but overlaying it with communities of color and other communities that might not be represented by ballot initiatives that white progressives might vote on, but maybe communities of color might need to be communicated to differently. And I think what SF Rising and Oakland Rising are doing is really important. As a supervisor from the West Side as well, wow, I'm up to about 3 minutes already, so let me start to say, as a supervisor on the West Side, as a radical and a progressive, I have to be very careful about framing, and I guess I use the George Lakoff framing to make sure that the language that I use is not the language of my enemies, that it's language that is forward-looking and positive, not so much what I'm against, but what I'm for, but also it's language that is hard to counter if you're for, and I'll use one of the examples from Local Progress, one of the groups that supports a lot of progressive elected officials. I'm for fair Security, Retirement Security, Equal Justice for All. It might sound like mealy-mouthed politician talk, but I think in my district, when I get out there, I can't talk about at times what my politics really is if I have to engage my neighborhood as well. But I think on the website, there's tremendous potential. And Emily Lee, who did a lot of the work to re-elect me in 2012, overwhelmingly, with a mainstream firm, 50+1, but I think the SF Rising group and many of the people in the room did a lot of work, even though you don't live in District 1, are the reason why I was re-elected. But also we, I think, framed well. We targeted very carefully, and we won, I think, every single precinct with the exception of one precinct. But I think it shows that with real strategic effort, but really it took the outside, lots of the social justice organizations, housing justice, and people that were in the Richmond, but we also helped to mobilize a Richmond district that was more progressive. We have an opportunity in districts 1, 3, 5, 9, and 11 to do this again. I'm hoping that at least one of the candidates from District 1 will make a decision very soon so that the SF Rising Action Fund and others will be behind her and many others that are running. But I think it has to be not just looking district by district, but a citywide strategy. I also wanted to say, too, that I still think that for the Richmond District, the displacement crisis and the eviction crisis is the number one issue as we're facing seniors and families and everyone in fear of whether they're going to be able to stay in the Richmond. And I think that is the overarching. The character of neighborhoods and the fear of being pushed out of the Richmond or out of the city is kind of the big issue. And I think it's very similar to many other neighborhoods, so I would frame it a little bit differently as I speak to Richmond District people. But I would say, too, that the creation of entities like SF Rising and Oakland Rising, but also the Progressive Voter Project during the Machiavelli campaign emerged for a few years, but reproducing efforts to take advantage of the absentee voter upsurge, but also ensuring that people continue to participate, not just election by election, but year round as well. I think building the infrastructure for the outside is so critical. Ballot measures help to do that if you get signatures to place something on the ballot or you mobilize for it. So even though we lost with Prop G and the anti-speculator tax, it builds for the future, even in the more west side districts where it seems to go heavily against G. But I think if we look at the data very carefully for what the tenant organizations and the movement did, it gives us a lot of places to really build off of. I just wanted to also say that I think the base building organizations, the social justice groups, and the progressive side of labor is really critical to be a part of that broader coalition to ensure that we don't keep getting our asses kicked as progressives and that we move towards that inside and outside that's healthy and that there's good communication among the progressives on the board of supervisors and new alliances with even others that may not be progressive on the board. And then even with the aides, so it's great to see that some of the aides from our offices getting together and communicating with the allies in the outside as well, so that it's not just the elected officials, but it's those that do the work in our offices, but also the social justice groups and progressive labor and others that are building on the outside as well. But that's what I'll share with you today. Thank you.
Elected and then re-elected, what sort of messages do you share to everyone that you made that happen?
I guess that's a really hard one. I try very hard when I'm with an audience that understands what being a progressive is. I'll use the term, or if we're talking radical socialists, others that are in the room will talk in a different language. When I'm with a
neighborhood.
And I think I try to find the common ground issues that nobody wants to be in fear of losing your home or having the business that you've been going to for decades be closed down because of a new condo building being built on top of it. But I think it's I try to find where people are at. But I also try to challenge and push back on conservatism, whether it's people trying to push the homeless out of parks at night or other issues. But I try to frame it in compassionate talk, not trying to kind of demonize people's fears. But I think that's one of the lessons I've learned is I try to find the common ground with people that I'm dealing with. Sometimes they might not agree with me on a social justice issue, but they might agree on an economic justice issue, for example. I think if I'm in a more progressive district, for example, with different organizations, my language changes. But at the Board of Supervisors, though, we have an opportunity to push back on conservative ideology and with policies. So I think when we make our remarks, I think it's really important to counter the dehumanization, the racism, sexism, homophobia that are put out there. But even the trickle-down economics that Supervisor Campos in a great editorial that I believe was a joint process for the office laid out just all the basic economic arguments. But if you don't demonize the people that you're arguing against, but you lay out really rational and humanize people, I think there's more of a common ground to build bigger alliances even on the west side as well.
So there's a lot of specific positions I don't think Eric has time to go through right now, but I'll give them to you.
Successful campaign. Nate will be talking to us about winning vote by mail and the realities of political fundraising.
Of course, it's Windows.
So it looks like a pie chart. But yeah, so we've been thinking about losing and what it means to be a loser. And one of the things that's interesting about politics is it's an up or down. It's a winner or a loser. So that often makes us start to think a little wonky about how campaigns went or strategies that campaigns use. People who win, we might think that everything they did was good, or people who lose, we might have a tendency to think that everything they did was bad. So we've been thinking about how can we take this loss and turn it into something positive. What can we learn and pass on to the progressives who are coming up next, and what are new strategies that we can try? So from these internal conversations, we've come up with a few ideas. But I am going to need my PowerPoint. Okay, so don't dangle on the speaker is the first lesson we learned from moving. Or keep it a foot away. How are we doing, guys?
Too close.
No. Can you very, very humble slice of pie there. We also, if you look at the, if you're looking at the breakdown, and all other people have already talked about this, but well, we lost, pretty significantly with vote by mail. We won pretty significantly on election day, and this is a trend that's been happening with progressives for a while now. We've been talking about it for a long time now, but yet it still keeps happening to us. And you may think that we might have, as a campaign, gone in knowing perfectly well that we have an advocacy problem as progressives and did nothing about it. We didn't. We had a strategy that we tried, which was, we're trying to think of new ways that we can, deal with our vote by mail problem. So, sorry guys. Kind of like that. Those dreams you have when you're up on stage and you don't have them. I'm having it right now. And I'm not naked. Yes. All right. Maybe it gets any more tricky here. Okay, so advocacy polling. The most progressive district. So does anybody know what the most progressive districts in San Francisco are?
Nine.
So nine is one of them.
Five.
Six is one of them. Five is one of them.
Eight
is no longer one of them. Oh my goodness, is it all happening? So this looks like Professor Cook's computer. Okay, so 8, 5, 6, 9, I'm sorry, 10 is the last one, right? And does anyone know which three things are least likely to vote
Nate.
Absentee?
Name of your file.
5, 6, 9.
Name of my file is... Yeah. Oh, yes! Oh, yes.
I'm so excited. Okay, great. So this is vote by mail versus polling.
Almost entirely vote by mail program, like in the next election. Should probably think otherwise. Next slide. This is that painful pie that I'm talking about right here. 49-51. Next slide. This is our vote by mail. So Chewed is significantly better than us. Next slide. That's the pie I like a lot more, but it's not enough to win, right? So this is our polling pie. Next slide. So most progressive districts. So you guys all got them, D9, D5, D10, and D6. So this is the next slide is what is the most least likely to vote absentee. Next slide. Oh, sorry, yeah, there we go. So yeah, exactly the same. So that's one of our problems that we're really looking at here that no one's really talking about. The progressive districts aren't registered to be absentee voters. So how do we deal with that as a movement? How do we go forward? And one of the things that we've been doing is we've been asking our candidates to deal with it in the middle of the election. So we're telling people, all right, like, you need to run your normal campaign, you need to deal with media, you need to deal with volunteers, you need to raise a ton of money, which we'll talk about later. And then also, you need to be registering people to do vote by mail. So that's just not going to work. We're never going to win unless we start thinking about it on the off election year. So who are the people that we need as a movement to sign up to be vote by mailers? So this is the voter base. The reason why Chinese isn't on here, because the Chinese is obviously a huge part of any strategy, is because they are predominantly signed up to be vote by mail already. The Chinese community has done a fantastic job of making this happen, and we have so many lessons to learn from what they did, right? So one of the problems that we've been thinking about with how do you sign these people up? So if I am going to knock on a door, if I'm trying to emulate the Chinese method, if I'm going to go and talk to somebody, we know that if your last name is Chinese, about 80% likelihood that you're actually going to identify as Chinese. We don't know who these people are or where they are. That's a real problem with the progressive movement right now. So African American, there's no common last name. We actually don't know from any data who you are. Latino, you can have a Latino last name, but that doesn't necessarily mean that you're going to identify as a Latino, which was a real problem that our campaign had when trying to reach out to Latino voters. LGBT people, if anybody knows a way to identify, I would like to know. And then tenants, right? And tenants, have, you know, also, that's one that we have a lot more information on. But to be useful for vote by mail, we need to know tenants who are going to stay living where they are, right, for a long time. And that's something that we're having to work on, too. And then the other piece of this that is important is you need to be LGBT and be progressive. So one of the lessons we learned from this last election was being queer doesn't mean you're going to vote for the queer candidate anymore. So when we did polls, we did well with LGBT people who were liberal and progressive, but moderates went for David Chu. So interesting thing that we all have to start thinking about in the future. So next slide. Okay, so that's supposed to be another thin circle there. So we're talking, in our office we've been talking about what are the strategies, and we've kind of come up with two sets of things that we think the community needs to start talking about. So one is, you know, organizing solutions. So the Venn diagram kind of works in, you know, three ways here. And also, if you're looking at what the Chinese community has done to get people signed up as absentee, it's not monolithic. They've done lots of different things. But we've kind of broken it down into three things. So one is we need to ID who our people are. So there needs to be some sort of in-between campaign structure or movement or program, or if people are talking about the Progressive Voter Project, or maybe the Liberal Voter Project is a more appropriate term now. But people who are knocking on doors and saying, hi, I'm with the Democratic, you know, voter sign-up project. Do you identify as Latino, white, Asian, Filipino? Marking that down. Do you identify as liberal, progressive, moderate? Do you identify as LGBT, straight, bi? Collecting that data, oh my gosh, 1 minute left. Collecting that, do I get a little more because of my, yeah, my nightmare? Okay, cool. Actually asking those questions and then collecting that data and then giving it and using it during election. We also need to be, of course, registering people. That should, any part of any progressive movement, that's something that we should be doing, is getting out there, finding our folks who are disenfranchised and signing them up. And the third thing is we need to be turning out those people who we have already identified, already know who they are, and getting them to vote. So all of these things need to happen in between elections, and they need to be everyone coming together to make that happen. No single group can do it. Next slide. These are some of the electoral things that we have been tossing around, and we want to kind of present and start a discussion on. And there's lots to talk about. So one of the first things, and this is happening right now, this is a debate happening in LA County, about moving elections. So I personally believe, and there's definitely certain sets of data to talk about this, that the mayor's office is going to be out of reach for us until we move it to a presidential election year. So having a discussion about, is it worth it, and this is what they're talking about in LA right now, to say give Ed Lee one more year to actually have the next mayor's race happen in 2020. That's something we can talk about. All of those happening on the presidential election year will of course make things more progressive, and then other options we can have if we move them. So Swiss voting. The Swiss style is everybody gets an absentee ballot mailed to them, and then they can do one of two things. They can go and drop it off at a polling place, or they can mail it back. So that's something that Supervisor Combos has been talking about, that we're thinking might be something that the progressive movement wants to start talking about to put on the ballot for 2016. Another idea is neighborhood voting. So I know at some point in the past, Willie Brown somehow sneakily got one neighborhood voting in a section that he was interested in getting more votes on. But what that would look like was rather than just having City Hall the entire month, we actually say for every neighborhood, there's a place where you can vote any day, every day, you know, as much as we possibly can for a full month for people to drop off those Swiss ballots. If we're not doing the Swiss ballots, just go and vote. Next thing is the Seattle model or the Washington State model, all vote by mail. Do we start thinking about this? If this is the trend, and we know that this is the trend of getting more and more vote by mail, should we need to suffer in this period where our people aren't the people that are signed up for vote by mail and therefore aren't voting? Or should we just pull the trigger and sign up everybody to vote by mail? Yes. That's another conversation you can have.
Wait, let's talk about fundraising before
we
run out of time.
Yes. Okay. And also, a public advocate like New York had to actually start talking about some of these issues might be something to start the dialogue. Last slide. Fundraising. So this is our fundraising, kind of broken down for you guys. So we broke the record for most spent on an assembly campaign, except for one other person, who was David Chu. So this is, if you look at how much money was spent, as my grandma used to say, this is a shit ton of money, right? Like, this is crazy. And where this split, we kind of break down by vote, Chu ended up spending $47 per vote, we ended up spending $32. So, yeah, we made him work for it here. This is really important to face the reality of. This is IEs included. So you can see the IEs are broken down, and then our IEs are broken down over there. You know, labor was really there for us, the nurses were there for us. SS Rising just did the most amazing thing any candidate could possibly want. But, you know, we didn't compete. They had $1 million more than us. So the next slide. This is the trends we're starting to look at for supervisor rates. So in 2008, you know, Chu was the only one that started to raise a significant amount of money. Everyone else won by raising what would be a moderate amount of money. Then you get to 2010, and you have Wiener and Farrell are, you know, through the roof. They're doing almost 500,000 campaigns. Then you get to 2012, we're starting to raise even more. And then Cohen, you know, is almost to, you know, 400,000 or so. So if you look at the top six people who've raised the most in supervisor races, only one of them is progressive, and that's Supervisor Mark. And Chu, other people didn't even identify. So red are people who considered themselves moderates when they were running. Chu, I would say probably, you know, I don't think we can call him a progressive anymore. So we have to start thinking about raising money that it, as progressive, before we had this idea that we could use knocking on doors that would make it so we didn't have to raise money. I think because of Citizens United, those days are over, and we have to start really, as a movement, thinking about that money is also part of what we have to give. So who gave the supervisor compost in the last race? Okay. So if everybody in this room, and then maybe some of you guys weren't supporting, but if everyone in this room had given $100, we're really starting to cook a fire there, right? the progressives have to kind of switch their mentality of money is also something we give as well as our time. That's something I think, yeah. That's it, I think. Is that my last slide? Cool.
Great. Really hammered up that much. And that it was the extra $1 million that got spent to get stuff. As far as the textbooks do, I do think it seems like it's looming and it's scary. But I also want us to, you know, stop and think about, like, who identifies as a tech person? And are they going to vote along the lines of as a tech person? And, you know, my partner works in tech. I have a lot of friends who work in tech. And I don't want to give up this extra $10,000 that Professor Cook is talking about. I think that we have more in common with them than not. And we need to find, that a lot of those people are gay. Do they identify as gay? Or do they identify as tech? A lot of those people are Chinese or Filipino or lots of other identities. Those are who we need to be reaching out to and bringing towards that.
And one more question. This has come up in different contexts, so not just about campaign, but the question about insiders and outsiders. And not really a question in both for some of the different instances that I've had, but I guess some people are feeling like they're left out.
I mean, being left out of the concept of progressive, is that, or from campaign?
From campaign, but also from the campaign.
So I think that the word progressive, you know, we may be better suited to do what Supervisor Marr is doing and use it a little bit more selectively. I'm trying to use the word reclaim liberal, take that back. But I also identify as myself as a progressive, and so it is something I take pride in, so it's hard to shift that. I can see why people are troubled. As far as being involved in campaign, best way to get involved is to walk in the door. We could have used you, so.
Thank you.
All right, so let's move on to our next speaker, Emily Lee. Emily Lee is a leader of San Francisco Rising Action Fund, a 501c4 organization whose mission is to build the political power and voice of working class communities of color in San Francisco. Emily is experienced in leadership development, political education, and organizing. Recently, she played a key role in running a citywide community labor independent expenditure to elect David Compos for assembly, raise the minimum wage, and protect affordable housing. Emily is a recognized leader in electoral organizing with particular expertise in multiracial alliance building, community labor partnerships, volunteer engagement, multilingual field operations, and ethnic media. So we're very happy to have her here. Emily will be talking about how we engage and organize within communities with an eye towards long-term investment. Thank you. Can you hear me?
Hey everyone, good evening. I'm really excited to have this conversation. I feel like there's been so many questions that we've been grappling with in our organizations, in our, volunteer spaces, and the places where we're actually trying to say, how do we keep San Francisco for the communities who built it, right? The communities who are working here every day, who are teaching our kids, who are the ones out there keeping it running, right? And for myself, as part of SF Rising Action Fund, and also our sister organization, San Francisco Rising Alliance, which is a C3 that has 8 other grassroots organizations who are part of it, including Poder, MUA, CTA, Casa Justa, Just Cause, and Power, which recently just merged, Coleman, I see Kevin back there, shout out to Coleman, the Labor Program, the Women's Collective, Filipino Community Center, as well as South of Market Community Action Network. You know, our communities have come together because we're fighting, for our families to be able to have an opportunity to stay in San Francisco, right? I think, it's really important as folks are talking about the way that San Francisco is changing, how do we look at what does that mean for us, but also, especially on this thing around the fundraising tip, I think, we're never going to have enough money. We're never going to outspend the other side, right? Because that's just a reality. So I think it's good to recognize the way tech money is playing in elections, but also that our strategy is never going to be just about raising as much money as they do, right? I think that's pretty clear. And also that, as Eric was pointing out in his 2012 election, you were outspent,
$1 billion.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, so it wasn't just about the money. It was actually about what was the multiple levels of strategy that we did to win that district race, right, and to keep that district progressive. So I feel like I learned a lot. That's kind of where I really learned about, you know, how do we run elections in campaigns in San Francisco when the odds are against you, right? The odds are stacked against you. And that it's still possible for a progressive movement to win. And Eric was joking, I think, saying that this side is the hopeful side. But this election was a reality call that, hey, if we want to win, it means we have to throw down in new ways, right? Try new strategies. And I think my main point on this panel is really about, you know, we have to really invest in the community if we want to win the voting bloc. It's not just about winning that vote. It's about how do we win over that community, right? And I think that's the strength of organizations like SF Rising because, you know, Diana asked this question at the beginning. She said, you know, what do we do about the progressive movement when there isn't an election looming? And that says a lot about the state of the progressive movement if we don't know the answer to that question, which is organize, right? So I think it's pretty clear that, you know, the organizations that we represent, we're the ones interacting with the community and voters year-round. It's not just about an election cycle, right? And I think we can't take working-class communities for granted, right? We can't take them for granted. We need a sophisticated strategy. We have to win. You know, I hate to use military reference metaphors, but, you know, it's like the air, war as well as the ground. You know, it's like we need to win it. We have to do it all, okay? So, right, it's not just about door knocking, but it's about what's the kind of sophisticated, robust communication strategy that we have to be dedicating to these voters. And it has to be informed by organizers who are on the ground. And I think that's part of what people are saying is the progressive movement out of touch with people? Right, that's some of the questions that have come up is, yeah, can progressives relate to regular people who don't identify as progressives, but who probably care about being able to stay in their home and being able to keep their kids in the school district, right? I think that's kind of where it comes to play that you need good organizers, right? You need people who are skilled in that to be able to, you know, get that message, right? So that we're not just talking to each other all the time and using that same lingo. And I feel like, you know, the Prop G campaign, like, you know, Maria always tells me this stat about how actually in the 2015 there's been how many LSAC evictions so far?
Zero.
Less than three LSAC evictions, right? We're at the end of February. Right? Why did that happen? It was because of Prop G and the fight that was started in, you know, 2013 for that. So I think it's really important that we don't take Prop G also that loss at the polls to mean that it didn't have an impact, because it clearly does, because it's on the forefront of the conversation in San Francisco, and developers and landlords are scared, you know? If they know that if there's going to be an LSAC eviction, there's going to be people who are going to mobilize around it. And I think the other side around Prop G is that, you know, we moved a lot of Chinese voters over with very little resources. And it still wasn't enough to counter the other side's lies and propaganda. But you know, just because we would have assumed that, well, if you're a tenant or you're a working class person, like you should vote for G, right? But the reality is that the other side is, you know, they're competing for those votes too, and they're spreading a lot of fear and confusion in the community. And far less on our side than should have been, even just based on their own pure self-interest, right? But I think it is, you know, folks did move, you know. The polls that were done in the Chinese community around Prop G, at first, there was the first poll that they did was actually saying it was 29% support, and by the end, it moved up to like over 50%, right? So that's a huge way that we actually saw that people can be moved, right? And I think, particularly in the independent expenditure that we worked on as SF Rising Action Fund, along with our labor and other community partners, Families for an Affordable San Francisco, we found that the combination of use of field and communication strategy really actually resulted in a big increase in terms of low propensity voters. So the district, the assembly district, number of low propensity voters was 24% who voted in that election, right? For our IDs that we said that they said they were going to vote our way, it was 35%, right? So it's like our field campaign and our communications campaign is able to actually turn those low those country voters, it makes a difference, right? So I don't want us to give up on the voters who are voting at the polls on the day of, right? And I think the other thing is that, talked a little bit about to you, is that, you know, how do we have two different campaigns, right? Pro-G and anti-G, telling voters the exact opposite thing. Who are they supposed to believe, right? The people who have the, you know, more fancy, translated, colorful advertisement, or like, you know, mailers. You know, we saw they were mailing to the Chinese community pictures, color pictures, like almost like a family photo album to Chinese voters, saying these are the people who are going to be hurt if Prop G passes, right? So they're targeting our community for sure. And so how do we actually expose the other side's lies in a way where the community understands, like, oh, okay, I'm getting all this mail, but I know who's really behind it. I know who is benefiting from this, right? And I think that requires a more sophisticated communication strategy than most mainstream consulting groups are going to want to do, media, right, in where they're consuming that media. And I think the last point I'll end with, so I have 1 minute, is that we really have to play the long game, right? And a lot of people are saying, you know, it's GOT on October 6th now, it's not November 4th, right? But it's not even about October 6th. It's like, it's way earlier than that. Investment in communities is not just 2 months before the election day, 3 months, you know, six, yeah. It's about cultivating those institutions in the community who are going to present a choice to people so they get to choose what side they're on, right? And I think the main thing is just that those communications, in order for them to work, they have to come from people who are on the ground talking to them, right? So we can't divorce strong organizing and strong field with, like, savvy communication. And I guess I'll just end there. We're not all the same. And I think definitely the work of, like, the Action Fund, which is about actually addressing working class communities of color across the spectrum on issues like Prop 47, you know, like Prop 30. It's actually about how do we unite the communities around this. And, you know, I think there's some people who are going to say, you know, Chinese voters are not progressive. You know, they're not worth investing in because they're never going to go our way. And frankly, that's pretty racist. I think that there hasn't been a serious long-term investment in the Chinese community around organizing and assessing what's possible. You know, I think that we can't just give up a whole block of people in our city and say, like, okay, here, you guys can have them, you know, on the other side, long time away, you know, you can have our whole community. And for us, you know, we really built, through our work as the Chinese Progressive Association Action Fund, we've really built up, ever since 2010, when At the Brighton started, we built 15,000 to 20,000 IDs of Chinese voters. Each election cycle, we're identifying them, people who we think are going to vote our way, right, working class Chinese people. And maybe they don't vote our way every single time, but it's like, what are the experiments we're going to try to basically get them to be more and more progressive voters consistently? And that's what we're talking about, is that long-term investment of, hey, let's try some different things, let's see what can happen, right?
So I know that you went over a lot of this already, but maybe there's still some questions that were earlier and some now about kind of keeping the momentum in communities of color and not just kind of weather the crisis or an election. So maybe people are wanting to have like specific examples as an individual that might help.
Yeah, and I think a really great example is the Prop J victory last year. I think a lot of progressives took it for granted, actually, that, like, oh, you know, the mayor's supporting it, so of course it's going to pass, you know, whatever. It's not, like, let's not work on that. It's not important. It's not progressive enough, right? But the reality is that, you know, would never have been on the ballot. We wouldn't have the highest minimum wage in the country right now. Unless, like, organizations like Progressive Workers Alliance were actually waging a campaign 5 years ago to talk about wage theft and talk about how people aren't getting paid a minimum wage and can't survive in the city. And so I feel like, you know, that type of work, that type of organizing 5 years ago made wage theft, you know, household name in city politics. It was a national issue. It became very matter-of-fact. Of course you would support a minimum wage increase, right? But, you know, I think we shouldn't dismiss all the organizing that happened and also the community and labor partnerships that had to come together to create that, you know, that is a good example of, like, yeah, it's not just that one-off time. It's, like, what it took to get Pop J to win it so easily was 5 years of hard organizing, right? And, like, building those relationships between community groups that are, you know, worker centers, and they're the ones who, you know, domestic workers, restaurant workers, day laborers, you know, really getting them to raise minimum wage as an issue in the city. And then to get elected officials to basically say, oh, yeah, of course we're going to support this. Of course. It's so, you know, obvious. But, you know, 5 years ago, it wasn't obvious.
Thank
you.
So closing us out tonight is Maria. Maria Zamudio is an organizer with Causes That Just Cause. She's the San Francisco Housing Rights Organizer. Her work is centered in the Mission District, where she has the privilege of working with, organizing alongside, and learning from some of the most inspiring, resilient, and badass tenants fighting for their homes and the rights to their neighborhoods. She deeply believes in the power of organizing working class people of color to bring out the to bring about the world we all know is possible and that we truly deserve. When she's not fighting slimy market rate developers and other tools of the gentrification machine, she likes to go hiking with her three-legged dog, Chuleta. Maria will be talking to us today about some challenges and models for effective DOTB, Get Out the Vote Plan story.
Maybe some of you all have seen him. He's one of our lead members. His name is Don Candelario. He is a quiet, humble, 62-year-old Salvadorian man who before 2014 had not thought about the electoral system in the United States at all. He actually comes with a wealth of knowledge and experience running and winning campaigns in El Salvador for years. But when coming to the United States, because he didn't actually get his citizenship until last year, the United States' electoral system just wasn't relevant to him. It wasn't something that he engaged with. So when we began talking about a ballot initiative as a way, as a tactic, to fight back the speculation that was happening in the Mission and in San Francisco, I literally saw his eyes light up. Because he was saying, finally, our tactics are scaling up to the need that to meet the need of our communities. And he helped put together the Mission Excelsior Tenants Convention in November of 2013. He helped put the citywide tenants convention together in February 2014. He was at every single Prop G action, and he brought, you know, five other members that he had turned out. Once election season came, he was working somewhere. He was walking streets. He was making phone calls. And he worked multiple 12-hour days during GOTV. And so I tell you this story. Oh, and he even tried to make sure that his citizenship process happened faster so that he could vote on November 4th. He told me. He was like, I want to vote for David Campos, and I want to vote for Prop G. It didn't happen. He got his approval letter like a month afterwards, and I didn't hear the end of it. He was just like, I hate this country. They didn't let me vote. But I tell you this story because this is the kind of long-term power building in communities of color that is surprising and goes up and stuff. This is why we do electoral work, right? So we know that we need working-class Black, Brown, and Asian leaders to be able to win the electoral field. And it goes beyond just one single election cycle, and I think we've heard it multiple times. It goes beyond one single candidate, one single campaign. It's a long-term process. And it needs to be coupled with rigorous community organizing when elections aren't happening. So just to give you a little background about why Salsa does civic engagement work, or electoral work, we call it civic engagement. We see it as a tactic, right? We see it as a tactic to be able to win back our cities, and it's another way to build our folks' power, right? We're trying to develop leaders. We're trying to develop working class people of color's leadership who've been told time and time again that their leadership doesn't matter, that they shouldn't be leaders. We're saying, no, you actually are leaders. You have an incredible amount of power, and here's another practice ground for you to work that out on. We also know that our communities don't have faith in the electoral system. We put a lot into it, and we don't often get a lot out. We also know that the electoral field is not one we're going to seize. We need to stay in that field, and we
need to continue working with it to meet our greater goals, right? That's just the reality. And so for us, like I said, like civic engagement work, the electoral work, is a tactic. It's not our ultimate goal. Our ultimate goal is a people-powered, people of color-led movement for progressive change that will actually eventually turn the tides in our favor. And our favor is one in which, as humanity, we're actually being developed and we're being invested in instead of just kind of grinding for profits, right? So that's the goal. The electoral work is just one of the tactics we get there, how we get there. So last year, Casa Justa worked incredibly hard to not only pass, but to actually develop from the ground up Prop G, the anti-speculation tax. And what we learned from that campaign is that actually a strong skills program is really important, especially if you want to turn out voters of color. So for the Prop G, as Prop G, we were a pretty small campaign. We didn't have that much money. And what we actually did was we actually worked strategically with other programs throughout the city to be able to put our volunteers and to put some of our capacity where it really matters. And when we ran our programs, we made sure that our programs were also smart and tactical. So we ran fields in 9, 10, and heavy districts, 4 of them in Park Merced and 5 of them in the inner Richmond. When we went into those places, no one had been talking to them. In Park Merced, you ask people, they had no idea an election was going on until we came and talked to them. In the 4 Park Merced precincts, we ID'd 96% for G. 96% of our door knocks were for G. And in the inner Richmond, and in the inner Richmond, in the 5 precincts, our ID level was at 85%. In all but 3 of those districts, Prop G won by a pretty big majority. And these precincts didn't have a lot of turnout. They were pretty low turnout. So it was a low turnout election. You know, I'm not saying that there were thousands and thousands upon thousands of voters coming from these 9 precincts, but the voters that did come out voted for G. And so for us, that shows us that a rigorous field program during the election actually has to be a continuation of the organizing that we're already doing in those neighborhoods, right? So the year-round investment that we're doing in communities of color. Our neighbors need to know who we are. So when I knock on a door and I say, hey, my name is Maria, I'm from Causa Justa, I'm here to talk to you about Prop G, they know who I am, they know who Causa Justa is, and there's a level of trust when talking to a Latino voter about electoral work, right? There needs to be a way in which we're building trust with our communities. And the reality is that, like Nick said, Black and Latino voters tend to be progressive if they vote. If they vote. That's the thing, right? So we need to make sure our job is to push back on actually a really long history of disenfranchisement in our communities. And because of this kind of parachute-style electoral work, which none of us do, right? None of us believe in that. There's actually a lot of mistrust around the voting, around elections and the electoral system. So year-round investment in the fights that are actually agitating our communities and in the things our folks care about, like on the daily, that's the stuff that's going to get our folks out to vote during the election. And by history of disenfranchisement, I want to talk to us a little bit about why Locande has been a registered resident, has had his green card, has been a resident in the United States since 1995, but it wasn't until 2014 that he got his citizenship, right? So we need to start. We, as Justa Justa and as the Rising, we talk about growing electoral power, and we also talk about growing the electorate. We need to get more Black and Latino voters registered early, registered to vote by mail. We just need to get them registered. We need to get Latino voters to register as citizens, which again is going against that idea that the electoral system is one in which we don't trust. So we need to grow it and turn them out. And that means, like I said, a deep investment and it's not just a deep investment overall throughout the year, but it's also an investment in rigorous program, right?
So we need to actually invest. I'm sorry. It's really frustrating. So we need to actually invest in the kind of field programs that are actually going to turn our folks out. That means they are as resourced as the media plan. They are as resourced as the mailings. We make sure that our door knockers are trained and know what to do and know where they're going and know how to talk to folks, right? How many of you have knocked on the door for the first time ever? Maybe some of you don't remember. Do y'all remember your first time knocking on a door?
Yeah.
It was so scary. I was 15 years old when I first knocked on the door, and I was shaking. I was like a chihuahua. But as I did it, more and more, it became powerful, right? So in the last minute that I have, I want to talk to you about San Francisco Rising and kind of building a long-term coalition to it. So San Francisco Rising is part of a statewide organization called California Calls, who is building political power to overturn Prop 13. It's not a small feat. It's going to take us a really long time, but we've been actually making inroads in that. We supported and helped pass Prop 30 a couple years ago, and last year, in the election in 2014, we actually passed Proposition 47, which is helping decriminalize California and moving people out of jail and funding into schools and other types of supportive services so people don't go to jail. That's the kind of long-term vision and the kind of political power that we're building statewide to be able to get those wins. Getting rid of Prop 13 is going to take a long time, but if you do a protracted effort over time, you build that political power. We're doing that through California Calls, and we're also doing that locally in SF Rising. Since 2012, SF Rising has built a 17,000 supportive voter base through rigorous field programs. We do that through rigorous field programs because that's how we're going to win, right? Let's see, what else do I want to talk about? Oh, the last thing. Okay, that's it. That's all I got. I think we'll try and just not do the mic thing, but I'm very apologize to the ladies over there, and I didn't hold ears all day, but thank you very much for keeping. It's great to have so many people here, and we're going to move into the Q&A for everybody. That an individual can do to start participating, way before there's even a vote. Find the local organization in your neighborhood or in your city that's fighting for the issues that you care about and get involved with them. Start organizing along with someone. Get yourself a team, get yourself a base, get yourself a group of people that when an election comes, when you want to put something on the ballot, when you want to make something on the ballot pass, or you want to make sure something gets overturned, you have a team to kind of roll with, right? Elections, at the end of the day, are about numbers, and so is organizing. I can't show up at a Board of Supervisors meeting and want something to pass if it's just me and Grande. And we've done that before. And it passes. But that's not sustainable, right? So if you want to know one thing to do to help win progressive electoral fights, you find your neighborhood-based community organization, you find a progressive organization that you trust, that you care about, and you start organizing with them. And then when the elections come, you say, hey, we should probably go do something about that. Who wants to come register some voters with me in the Bayview?
So there's been a lot of questions and concerns about communities of color participating. I think you've raised a lot of them yourself, Emily and Maria, and the panelists. And there is that distrust. So how do you, in your work, and Emily can answer this too, break through that?
Yeah, I mean, I can go. One thing that we do with our members is right before any big election, so we do civic engagement programs every year. Actually, every year our members are doing some sort of electoral work, and that's through our Cali Calls Coalition, California Calls, right? And again, it's practice. Our members are practicing what being in the electoral field looks like and how that works. But before we do any major CEP programs, as we call them, because it's really hard to be like, okay, so 5 hours on a Sunday, see you there. It's really hard, right? Especially if multiple Sundays in a row. But what we do is we actually start with a history of where the right to vote came from. So we talk to our folks, so this is what happened, this is why we vote, this is where things kind of went sour for people of color. And then we kind of, again, talk about it as a tactic. It's not our goal. It's not the only thing that we do. Electoral work is not our it's not even our bread and butter, right? What we do is we actually stop displacement, make sure our immigrants are living with dignity in our cities, and fight for human dignity. So that's kind of what we do. And our members recognize that.
Amy Farrell-Weiss is here, who's also running for mayor. But I think it is a big void that there's not a strong labor back or progressive back person right now. But I know that as elections go forward, hopefully the grassroots organizations will challenge the positions of the mayor and to try to expose more of where he's not standing strong for real, as I think Joseph Booth from People Power Media, the amount of affordable housing that needs to be built, and a lot of the policies that he's proposing are very moderate, and hopefully people will challenge those policies as he promotes his 2015 re-election. But I sense that people realize that pouring resources into a losing campaign might be wasteful instead of building up the infrastructure and grassroots forces that we need as well.
Yeah, I agree exactly with Supervisor Mara. I do think we need to have a protest candidate, somebody to get out there and spread the message and ask questions of the mayor and kind of help frame what our discussion is going to be in 2016.
So, go my poll. If you look at the polling there, 6% approval. Strong approval is 12 to 15%. This support is this thin. So it is a huge, astronomical missed opportunity that there is not a serious candidate.
I'm serious.
I'm sorry.
not
that's the wrong word. That's the wrong word.
Yeah.
But a candidate with an opportunity to have a real debate with the mayor, where he will actually be forced to engage in these questions. Because he will not engage in these questions if he did not engage in these questions 4 years ago. But the thin support is unreal to me that we have somehow interpreted 60% approval, 12% strong approved, as somehow inevitable. It's flatly beyond me.
Eric Marr for mayor.
Yeah.
I would turn that again to the campaign. That to me is the among the many challenges, right? Is that candidates are in campaigns are IDing voters, they're connecting voters, and there is not. And oftentimes, to me, a lot of what happened in this election was progressives were split. G, K, compost, minimum wage. And then the campaigns that necessarily work together, they don't share data, we may ID voters for one campaign, not for another, we don't protect the data, and then you reinvent the wheel every couple of years. The other side maintains the data. So again, that has to be done at the campaign level. Down level of infrastructure building, candidate recruitment, we need to identify today. Progressive women of color in particular, with kids in public schools in particular, running for school board in 2016 and 2018, now, today, we need to identify those candidates. You need to build a bench so you're not left with candidates running for mayor who may have run for mayor a few times back. We have an ability to mobilize support in the community. But it comes down to how do campaigns work with each other? How do electeds work with each other? Just one quick thing, just because I've been here. So, ballot measure strategies are those are not sustainable. No votes always win, right? I mean, being on the yes side on ballot campaigns is very, very difficult. No is privileged, particularly when no has about $9 million. It's particularly privileged, right? So a ballot measure campaign is not a sustainable one. Doing this gets big money, because people are inclined to vote. Particularly in local balloting when they've already voted on like 50 other things, they vote more and more no as they go down the ballot, right? They vote more and more for the incumbent as they go down the ballot. Research shows the longer the ballot, the more they vote no, the longer the ballot, the more they vote for incumbent. If you're an incumbent, you want to be at the bottom of the ballot. If you're a challenger, you want to be at the top of the ballot, right? So ballot measure campaigns are not the strategy. Being on the yes side of ballot measure campaigns, particularly against big money, right? We have to figure out how we do this sort of long-term, everyone has also said, long-term strategies to mobilize community candidate recruitments. We're identifying candidates who will be running for mayor 4 years from now. It's really thinking about this in a long-term, much more integrated approach.
And there have been a couple questions about money. So this one says, hopefully for you, Nate, how can we compete against billionaires, but also for the rest of the panelists, how do we sustain this, everyday approach kind of to engaging our
And exactly what Emily said. We don't need to compete with billionaires. We need to have enough money to get our messaging out there, that's all. And when we start to get too underwater, so when there starts to be a huge imbalance, that's where it becomes very, very difficult to climb up that hill. So we have to be somewhat competitive, but we don't have to win. We're never going to raise more money. We don't even want to raise more money. We're always going to focus more on our people and turning out folks and knocking on doors. But, we did raise $1 million. So we've raised more than any progressive ever had. And I'll tell you the secret. There was none. It was just small little strategies. It was like when I asked everyone to raise their hand, that's how we did it. Everyone, we had people really deep down, dig deep and give. And that's a lot to ask from our community, who is not a wealthy community. But that's what it's gonna take to be at least somewhat satisfied.
Look at what voters in Richmond just did. Look what voters in Berkeley just did.
Mm-hmm.
Right? You can mobilize against big money campaigns because they are big money campaigns.
Yeah.
Talking about, related to that, turnout. How do we increase turnout? And we've talked about, we've had some diagrams, we've talked about participating in the community. What are some things that we can do to increase turnout in our neighborhood?
Sure. I just go back to a little bit of what Nate was saying, and it's like we just have to have a serious conversation about vote by mail and early voting, right? Emily always says this. She said this to me during the elections the whole time because I was freaking out about our turnout numbers. And Emily always says there is just no way we're going to turn out the thousands of IDs our campaigns get, because we ID thousands of people. There's just no way we're going to get all those people out on November 4th. It's impossible. Unless you're Obama and you're running a 100-person team at every single minute of November 4th, there's no way we're going to turn out the thousands of IDs that we have. So that means that we need, as Black and Latino voters, we need to get our registration game on. We need to get our folks registered. We need to get our folks registered early. We need to make sure that we're on those doors, talking to our folks early, right? I talked about how important field operations are. Field operations are just as important when we're doing early vote and vote by mail. That just means we just have to get out early, have conversations with our neighbors. And like Emily was saying, our members are the best ambassadors. You all are probably the best ambassadors to talk to your neighbors about early voting. You get your ballot, you knock on all the doors in your apartment building, and you say, hey, Lenyana, did you get your ballot? I got my ballot. You want to work on it together? That's actually how we do it at GoFound. Our folks come in, do a member meeting, and we fill out our ballots together. We don't fill out for candidates, because we can't. But we talk about the proposition, and we go through different ballots together, and so we do it as a community. Just like we organize for campaigns, just like we organize to get big wins, just like we organize to make sure people stay in their homes and we show up 50 people deep in front of a house so that our person doesn't get taken out by the sheriff. We need to do that. We need to take that model that we're so good at and kind of translate it to the electoral one.
Yeah, I was just going to add that Corey and I were just talking about ballot initiatives, and sometimes when they're developed by the grassroots movement and strategically placed on the ballot, Tech Ellison was a master at that, turning out tenants with pro-tenant measures that are framed populist ways, so it's not just the east side, but it's also west side voters that are going for that. It's another way to do that as well.
I'm just going to add that, Lydia's point about like, that takes resources, right? Resources to actually turn people out early and to register them early. And, you know, that's like a much longer investment than most people who donate to campaigns are willing to do. So it's like, where do we get the resources to do that kind of, like, year-round organizing, like we would say, and also the, like, the, your point that you made around, you know, folks just, they could register to be a citizen, but they haven't done it for 10 years. You know, that's a much bigger campaign to wage around kind of shifting the way people view voting in a community, right? Like, that's a big project. You know, that's not a six-month thing. That's, like, that's years, right, of, like, turning things around and getting people to understand why it's so important for them to vote and what's at stake, you know? So I just feel like there's that resource question about, you know, investment. You know, it's not always it's about people power, but it's also about what it takes, you know, the resources.
Last thing to add to that, I think it's really important. I think that we need to build an organization that is directly focused on electoral politics, that is a progressive organization. I think that we are so good at our community development, but part of being a progressive is being suspicious of electoral politics, rightfully so, we all should be. But there needs to be somebody who is holding down that fort throughout, you know, on the off cycle, who is leading us in the right direction and raising that money that she's talking about, giving that resources and doing the work.
And so thank you so much for everybody for sticking around.
Thank you.